Hey everybody, welcome back. I'm Seth Monahan, a guy who can't wait to actually teach his students face-to-face again, and I'm here today to talk about applied chords to four. Now, if you've been paying attention, you probably noticed that this video has a really similar title to lesson 26, which was called Applied Chords to Five. If you haven't seen that one yet, you may want to stop what you're doing, go back, and watch it, because that's where I introduce the concept of applied dominance, also known as secondary dominance, or just applied chords. And in this video, I'm going to assume you know exactly what those terms mean, and then just dive in. So if you know what applied chords are, you may be expecting a whole gallery of new chords in this video. After all, in video 26, we had a chance to meet 5 of 5, 5 7 of 5, 7 diminished of 5, 7 diminished 7 of 5, and even 7 half diminished of 5, many of them in different inversions. So you might expect pretty much the same thing today, except all the applied dominants would resolve to 4. 5 of 4, 5 7 of 4, 7 diminished of 4, and so on. But the truth is that in real music, there's a lot less variety among applied chords to four. One of them turns up way more than all the others, so I'm going to focus on that one almost exclusively today. It's 5-7 of four and its inversions. So let's think about how we might spell 5-7 of four. Here are the chords in C major. There's our four chord, F, and I hope you'd know by now that the dominant of F is C. So that means technically there are occasions where we could call the plain old tonic triad 5 of 4. But that's dumb. Nobody ever does that. So let's focus instead on 5-7 of 4, which actually requires a note from outside the key. To build it, we have to turn the tonic triad into a dominant seventh chord, which means we here need to add B flat, which is lowered scale degree 7. Now we've got 5-7 of 4, which I might point out is not ever called a 1-7 chord. A 1-7 chord would have a B natural in it. No, this is 5-7 of 4, and that B flat lowered scale degree 7 is the telltale note that helps us see and hear that chord in major keys. And in this sense, lowered scale degree 7 should remind you of raised scale degree 4 back in video 26, which was the calling card of all applied chords to 5. Well, unfortunately, we don't get a universal giveaway note like that today, because if we go to build 5-7 of 4 in minor, we'll see pretty quickly that lowered scale degree 7 is actually already part of the key and doesn't need an accidental at all. Instead, the telltale note in minor is raised scale degree 3. And again, that doesn't make this into some sort of major one chord. It's not a Picardy third or something like that. It's a chromatic alteration that turns tonic into a dominant seventh that resolves to 4. Now, admittedly, this is a bit tricky because it means we have to train ourselves to hear two different sonic markers. In major, we need to hear lowered scale degree 7, and in minor, we need to hear a totally different note, raised scale degree 3, to home in on the same chord. What's helpful here, though, is that both of those telltale notes are tendency tones. Lowered scale degree 7 is the chordal seventh, which will pull downward, while raised scale degree 3 is the chordal third, the so-called local leading tone, which pulls strongly upward. So let's start by seeing if we can learn to hear that telltale lowered scale degree 7 in major. Here is the slow movement from a Haydn symphony you've never heard of, and the texture here is very simple. In the middle, we've got muted strings, arpeggiating chords, and then above and below it, little two-note snippets of melody. And each of those two-note snippets gives us a tendency tone resolving, one after the other. 4 resolves to 3, and then 7 resolves to 1. But the first little melodic snippet in the cellos introduces a note from outside the key, C natural, or lowered scale degree 7. It's like a flare going up announcing that we're probably dealing with 5-7 of 4 in some way. And because that C natural is a tendency tone, a chordal seventh, it's going to pull very strongly downward. So on our first listen, I want you to focus on the particular color and the particular energy of that note. And if you can, I also want you to compare it to the distinctive color and energy of regular scale degree 7, which we hear at the end of the phrase. Here it is again. So let's add in an actual chordal analysis now. I want you to notice two things here. First, notice that I've given 5-7-4 the function of a tonic substitute. We've used this function before when 5-7 goes to 6, and the idea, again, is not that 5-7-4 sounds or feels like a tonic. What it means is that in terms of chord progressions, we often find 5-7-4 in a spot where we could have found a tonic chord, like here, directly following a dominant. The other thing to notice is that the giveaway note, the lowered scale degree 7, appears as part of a continuous chromatic line. Notice here that the real bass line goes from scale degree 1, down to scale degree 7, then again down to lowered scale degree 7, and then finally on to scale degree 6. This is something we see pretty regularly, and it's another instance of the so-called frustrated leading tone, which we saw in video 26, which is to say, a leading tone that is forced to resolve downward by half step rather than upwards, usually into another tendency tone in some other dissonant chord. Now I want to listen one more time, but now we're going to add the next four bars, and look what Haydn does here. Everything is the same except the register of the various parts. The accompaniment and the second melodic snippet are both down an octave lower this time. And the effect is that the bass line has changed. Now D goes down to C sharp and back. No more frustrated leading tone. And the chordal seventh of the applied chord, C natural, now appears in an upper voice, making this a root position, 5-7-4. Have a listen. So now that you've got that sound in your ears, let's listen to a few more instances of root position 5-7-4. Here's a beautiful one from Weber's Overture to Der Freischütz. And as it happens, Weber puts every chord here in root position to help give the tune a kind of rustic simplicity. There are two four-bar subphrases here, and the second one ends by taking the tonic, turning it into 5-7-4, by adding that lowered scale degree 7, and then resolving it to a root position 4. And notice that Weber's crescendo makes that applied chord the climax of the phrase. So 5-7-4 goes to a root position 4 here, which it does all the time, but it can also go to 4-6-4. Here's the opening of Mozart's K332 piano sonata, which has a full functional cycle unfolding over a tonic pedal. There's 1, there's 5-7-4, there's 4-6-4, then 7 diminished, still over a pedal, and then tonic again. This opening formula is extremely common, and I'm actually going to spend all of video 31 talking about it. But for now, just pay special attention to that E flat, a lowered scale degree 7, when it enters. So now let's hear a pair of examples that have 5-7-4 in minor. Here is one of Mendelssohn's Songs Without Words, and the whole first bar is just a vamp on the tonic E minor. But then in bar two, when the melody comes in, he turns that chord into a 5-7 of four. In other words, he makes E minor into an E dominant seventh chord before moving to four, which is A minor. And as I mentioned earlier, the giveaway note here would be raised scale degree 3, or G sharp, which appears in both hands. But let's go a bit deeper and think about the effect of 5-7 of 4 in minor, which is really different from what we find in major. To make 5-7 of 4 in major, we have to chromatically lower a note, scale degree 7, and then it has to drop by half step when the chord resolves. For me, all that downward motion creates a certain relaxation of tension. But we see the opposite in minor. Now we take a note and raise it chromatically. In this example, G becomes G sharp. And then it has to rise by semitone, in this case to A. For me, this has an intensifying effect. And when the tonic minor becomes a dominant seventh chord, it feels to me like it's been animated, like charged with a new kind of energy. And one of the cool things about this particular example is that this sense of mounting energy continues right into the next bar. Notice that as G sharp rises to A, another voice moves in parallel thirds, B up to C. Well, because Mendelssohn's next chord is 5-7 of 5, those parallel thirds keep going. A and C rise to A sharp and C sharp, and then those two notes move on to B and D sharp. So the arrival back on the tonic in measure 4 feels like a kind of momentous event. And then from there, everything slackens. The melody cascades down a minor 10th while the harmony moves through a much more mundane functional cycle. Here's another example in minor from a Chopin nocturne. This one starts with a two-bar idea that's repeated immediately with variation. The first time through, we see the same progression as the last example. Minor 1 becomes 5-7 of 4, resolves to 4, and then the phrase ends on 5-7. But in the second pass, notice that the bass line has one tweak. Now the applied chord to 4 is in first inversion. Now it's 5-6-5 of 4, which puts raised scale degree 3 in the bass, giving that chord an even stronger pull toward root position 4. Here's how it sounds. So taking our cue from this example, I want to shift our attention now to inversions of 5-7 of 4. But before we hear more music, let's take a second to think about the kinds of bassline patterns we should expect to see. If you watched video 19 about inverted dominance, you may remember this diagram, which maps out all of the bass motions we might see when an inverted 5-7 resolves. The bass of 5-6-5 always resolves upward to tonic. The bass of 5-4-2 always goes down, and the bass of 5-4-3 can go in either direction. Well, we can do the same thing for 5-7 of 4. Here we see that its three inversions have raised scale degree 3, regular scale degree 5, or lowered scale degree 7 in the bass. And as we might have guessed, the bass of the 6-5 version goes up, the bass of the 4-2 version goes down, and the bass of the 4-3 version can go either way. So let's start with a few instances of 5-6-5 of 4, which always resolves to a root position 4. Here is a gorgeous passage from Beethoven's Opus 110 Piano Sonata, and what can only be described as an obscene key signature, A-flat minor. Come on, Ludwig. Anyway, the basic framework here is a bass ascent from tonic up to dominant, harmonized totally conventionally. We've got 1, 5-4-3, 1-6, 4, and then a cadential dominant. But there are two extra chords here to notice, both in bar 3. Notice that between 4 and 5, Beethoven inserts a 4-6 chord. which helps him avoid parallel fifths, among other things. And then also, between 1/6 and 4, he inserts 5/6/5 of 4. In minor, this creates a rising chromatic bass line, lowered 3, raised 3, and 4, that should remind us of the 4 sharp 4 5 bass line we've seen so often with applied chords to 5. Here's how it sounds. Here is the same progression in a major key piece. This is Schubert's setting of Ganymede, and it starts and ends with some simple tonic dominant alterations. To start, we get this, and a lot of what follows is just ones and fives or five sevens. But at the climax of the phrase, in the fifth bar, 1/6 moves to 5/6/5 of 4, onto 4, and then onto the cadence. Now, notice here that in major, this progression doesn't make a chromatically rising bass line like it did in minor. That's because scale degree 3 is already raised. The applied chord has exactly the same bass note as 1/6. The difference between the two is just lowered scale degree 7 turns up in the second chord. So keep your ears peeled for that when you hear it. Here's one more example of 5/6/5 of 4 from the opening of Bach's B minor Mass. And I picked this one to show you that bass lines in minor can sometimes walk upward from tonic without passing through the diatonic scale degree 3 at all. I've isolated Bach's bass line on the staff below the reduction, and you can see that he walks up from 1 to 4 using only raised scale degree 3, where the applied chord is. And then notice as well that the phrase ends with the lament bass pattern we learned about in video 28. If you want to find applied chords to 4, one great place to look is in chromatic lament basses. Here's a passage we actually looked at in video 28, the famous When I Am Laid in Earth from Purcell's Dido in Aeneas. And it starts off with a progression sort of like the one we saw in our very first example. Tonic moves to 5/6/5, and then instead of going back up, the leading tone now drops down by half step into lowered scale degree 7. That's where our applied chord is. This is very common. And notice that to make the bass completely chromatic, Purcell resolves that applied chord to a major 4 chord with E natural in the bass, which then moves on to minor 4 and 5. If we want to see this progression again, we can go back to that A-flat minor arioso from Beethoven's Opus 110 sonata. Here is the very end of that section, and it's structured around a bass descent from scale degree 3 all the way down through a 7th to scale degree 4. And then back up to 5 for the cadential dominant. We start out totally conventionally. 3, 2, 1. Is harmonized alternating tonic and dominant. Then, when Beethoven descends from tonic, we see a similar progression to the one in Purcell. 5-6, 5-4-2-0-4, and then on to 4-6. But from there, Beethoven uses another applied chord, 5-6-4-0-4, to walk the bass down two more steps to root position 4. And as always, in minor, those applied chords to 4 stand out because they need raised scale degree 3, or C natural here. And then from there, it's just a regular cadence progression with a very drawn-out dominant. When we listen, notice that the MVP here is the alto voice, which could have just held a common tone E-flat in that first system. But instead, it snakes all around that E-flat chromatically to D natural and F-flat. So our last two examples are by Chopin and Beethoven, and they have a few things in common. They're both a little more complicated than our usual fare, and they both use 5-4-3-0-4 as a passing chord. Let's start with Chopin's E major nocturne, opus 62, number 2. His theme is built around two functional cycles, a short one and a long one. The short one is at the end. It's tonic, applied chord to 5, and then 5-7. For the half cadence. The other cycle takes 6 bars, and it's built around a bass line that descends by thirds. We start on tonic, we go down a third to 6, down another third to 4, down another third to 2, and then down a last third to 5-6-5. Now let's listen to how Chopin connects these chords. Between 1 and 6, we've got 5-7, which resolves deceptively. That's easy. Then between 6 and 4, we've got 5-4-3-0-4, an E dominant 7th, acting as a passing chord. Then Chopin does the same thing to go down another third. He uses 5-4-3-0-2 as a passing chord, leading into root position 2. And then for a bar and a half, he really leans into that 2 chord, reinforcing it with 2 more applied chords, before finally moving into the dominant that leads into the next cycle. Here's how the whole thing sounds. So our very last example is from Beethoven's first Opus 30 violin sonata. And like the Chopin we just heard, it's best understood in terms of an underlying framework that's then fleshed out with extra chords. And here that framework is even simpler. The basic progression under the surface is just 1-6-4-5. It's hard to imagine anything simpler than that. It's just your heart and soul progression. But the beauty is in how Beethoven embellishes it. The opening tonic gets just a simple away and back motion to 5-6-5. But the 6th chord coming up is decorated with 3 different applied chords. 6 is B minor, so these will be F sharp dominant 7th chords, and we lead in with an applied 4-3 and an applied 6-5. Then we go back to the 6-5 as part of a little neighbor motion in the bass. And then to prepare 4, Beethoven does the same thing down a third. Since 4 is G major, we're going to get 2 different inversions of the D dominant 7th, 4-3 and 6-5. And there, notice there is our giveaway note, the lowered scale degree 7, C natural. Then in the second system, both 4 and 5 get embellished by quick trips to tonic and back in the weak part of the bar. Here, and then here. Have a listen. So that, my friends, is your guided tour through 5-7 of 4 country. There's one more stop on that tour, though, and that comes in video 31, where we will talk about probably the most common idiom using 5-7 of 4, the so-called quiescenza. I'll see you there.